So today I'm going to talk about the prediction of the effect of sequence variation. The talk from Jana Schmidt, on the 19th is still unclear. It's expected for next Thursday, but there was a new question mark coming up. So to begin with the background, the slide, life is diverse, common to life, DNA, RNA, proteins, cells, those are, in some sense you could argue, only the parts. What's the principle that is common to life? Can I steal the thing? Thanks. Thanks. Any idea? What comes to your mind? Nothing? Well, often people would argue evolution is sort of the common principle. In fact, you could argue that life is evolution. Clearly, the life as we observe it results from an evolutionary process. So it has evolved the way it is. The fact it's a carbon-based life, and the conditions could have been different, possibly, and it could have been a non-carbon-based life. Who knows? But that has evolved. What we see as life today is something that was produced by a process we commonly refer to as evolution. Who invented it? Well, nature. But this is not what I mean. You know, if you put a name to a scientist, yeah. Darwin, right? It's a simple one. But if that is a simple one, what's the Darwin-Wallace theory? Ever heard of that? So let's go back into Darwin. Darwin did publish the book The Origin of Species, commonly seen as the beginning of the idea of evolution in 1859. This is a very big book, very, very thick book. It's very difficult to read. At least I found it very difficult to read. And remarkably, it has one figure. That's the figure. And I'm sorry for the reproduction. I didn't find a better version. Ultimately, this is the tree of life. So the common idea really is that we are all related through commonality in the ancestor. And here we get to Cherry. No, we're not getting to Cherry. We're getting to Alfred Russel Wallace. Darwin, Wallace, in 58, so a year before the publication of this book, in fact, to be more precise, on the 1st of July, 58, two papers were presented in London. So two papers presented in those days meant they were actually, somebody stood up and read those two papers. Those two papers.
The whole?
Yes. The papers were shorter. But yes, people also had more time. The whole paper, yes. So those two papers were two versions of the theory of evolution. The reason why this came that way, ultimately, is because the idea was first sort of put into the public by Wallace. And there was a pressure, so some people felt that Darwin deserved some credit. And this whole event was made in order to give some credit to Darwin too, because it was clear that Wallace would be there first. So there was sort of a political if you call it political, somebody sort of changed the way history went in some sense. And it was completely successful. You don't know the Darwin-Wallace theory, although Wallace was the one who got it first, the idea. Anyway, so if you want me to get her leashed up here, tell me, is she too, huh? Sit down at some point, okay? Mm-hmm. Yep. So ultimately, this is one of the results of the theory of evolution. So what you see on the x-axis is the number of residues aligned between two proteins, between a pair of proteins, and that's the percentage sequence identity. If you have two proteins that have 100 residues aligned, and at least 33 of these 100 are identical, essentially they have the same 3D structure. Okay, and if you did go into the lab of 100 residue protein and changed 5, it's very likely that you changed the structure. Why are these two? So nature changes 67, you can hardly change 10. Why is that? Ultimately, this is because a neutral change is very unlikely, relatively unlikely, difficult to find. And where you can change which amino acid against which other amino acid depends on the structure. Now, nature had enough time to explore possibilities. Simply what you see is a result of neutral, because other things that sort of messed it up died out. We don't see them. This is a tiny part of the possible sequence space. We only see what worked, right? And that is, again, evolution at work. So it creates an evolutionary profile. It creates the profile of what you can change at what position. PSSM is another way, position-specific scoring matrix or profiles, or there are all kinds of words for that. Ultimately, this is about evolution telling you how in that particular object, which constraints are important. So this is another view on evolution. This is another view on the molecular level on the validity of Darwin, if you want. So the packaging of DNA is, as you know, in chromosomes. Genes are wrapped up in chromosomes. We have here 23 human female chromosomes. And now on the level of chromosomes is where we discovered, where it was first discovered, how genomic variation comes apart. And there are different ways of genomic variation. So there's the simple thing where you insert something into a chromosome. There's deletion, so this opposites of each other. There's a duplication, so you take this piece and duplicate it and build a new one that's just containing this region twice. There's the inversion idea, so you, instead of reading it like that, you invert the sequence, which of course creates very different sequences here. This is the same as before, so essentially you put something in some sense you could call it an insertion, you put it in the wrong place. So you take it from one chromosome, put it in another chromosome, and all kinds of other things. These things do lead very often to very dramatic effects. Now when we look at the structure of a gene, so the most simple one, where we have an open reading frame here, we have a terminator, we have a beginning, so we have a regulatory sequence. So changes can happen everywhere. And the changes can be a single nucleotide, and the changes can be entire regions. They can lead to changing introns, they can lead to changing exons, they can lead to completely taking off exons. They can, in the coding region, change the amino acid. So there are many different levels that happen everywhere. SNP originally is the single nuclear polymorphism, is defined as one nuclear change that happens at a certain frequency. That's the original definition of it. Just to give an example about effect of change, it's the same thing we saw before. This is KRAS is one protein that is very known for cancer because it's the first so-called oncogene, so cancer-related gene, cancer-causing gene in some sense initially. The colors here simply help you move through the structure. There's no other reason for that. Now colors change here. The reason of color changes, what you see is this point mutation. So at position 12, you change a glycine to a cysteine. That's all that happens. The red one is the non-native version, the mutant version. And it's very clear that the red and the original one are very similar in structure and actually also in binding. So when you had these two structures, you may actually argue, well, there is no big effect here, and this is the same thing. This is the variant that causes cancer. So sometimes, and it is actually because the binding is completely changing, although the binding site looks relatively similar, the difference in functionality, so the degree to which it still functions, is importantly different, and that makes a difference for this involvement in cancer. Now here we get now further down, so 85% sequence identity we get in Lyme into a protein that is very similar to RAS in human, Again, similar binding site, similar binding mode, similar structure. We get further down in fly to 28% sequence identity. Now you already changed 62% of the residues in orange here, and is still relatively similar in the structure, and actually you still have a similar binding site. Again, the effectivity here is different, so just like for the mutant, but fly can live with that different situation. So it essentially does the same thing. Now we get further down, 90% sequence identity to human. We are in a bacterial world in purple here. The structure does begin to change. The binding site does begin to change. In this particular case, also the function changes. But still the scaffold is very conserved. So it's changed 81% of all the residues, and you still maintain the scaffold and some principles. And that again is this evolutionary principle. You evolved to create that. It's not it's that, that so it's a selection system, and that's the idea of evolution. We want to map the genotype to the phenotype. What this means essentially is from our genotype, we want to explain certain things that happen ourselves. So for instance, hair color, for instance, the way our skin looks, but also the way our skin is sensitive, or the way our health is sensitive to certain medication or to certain challenges. So how come that I cannot take a certain drug that others can do for hypertension or something like that? So here are some, by now a little bit outdated, results that I found amazing that happened from early sequencing. So this one here showed sequencing Africans, in particular Bushmen from the Kalahari, and comparing that to other species, showed that the variation in terms of sequence between the Bushmen is much higher and the variation between Chinese and us. Okay, so yes, everybody in this, every pair in this room differs, but we are much more similar to each other, we may assume, than any of us is from a Chinese, or most of us at least are from a Chinese. But this is now we can argue that when we look at these Bushmen, they look relatively similar. Kalahari Bushmen, they have all, essentially they are relatively short. They have a similar past. For me, they look similar. I cannot take them apart. But their genomes differs much, much, much more than we do from Asians. Europeans differ from Asians. That's one surprising result. And like always, when you observe something, you understand why this was the case. Although this was a big surprise, nobody expected it. But afterwards, of course, they always could explain why this was so. Anybody knows the explanation? Of course, it's not an explanation. But everybody today takes it as an explanation. Post-explanation. So after you observe the effect. Essentially, the idea is from many people believe in the idea that life originates from Homo sapiens originate from Africa, in fact from somewhere in the middle of Africa, from close to the Kalahari, from the Bushmen, and somehow the population goes out here, goes into Asia Minor, and from there to Europe and to Asia. That's the idea. Now, when you have a group with a certain genetic diversity, so that's the Ur group, so to speak, of Homo sapiens sitting here. And now you take a subset of this original group out. Then the diversity in the subset is smaller than the diversity in the entire set. Right? There's no way around it. By reducing the set, you reduce diversity. Some of the diverse ones. So you may argue that things can change over time, but of the original effective diversity, you change, you reduce, okay? And this essentially is the point here. The further you go down, the more you split, the more you reduce in diversity. It's a very, very intuitive, very understandable, very simple explanation, yet it could also have been happening by gaining. So again, this was a result that was surprising, that was not expected. This explanation existed before, so it is not the entire story. Okay. Here's another story that I personally found very interesting. Is again, it was done by finding some residual organic part from somebody they did not realize was Homo, and then they finally realized it was a Homo sapiens in Greenland. And sequencing that person, they realized that there was a migration to the Americas long before what we call the Native Americans today, so long before the population that we know of. So this was the first time that there was evidence of a migration before the migration that we are aware of. And in fact, not only before, but 5,500 years before. And those kind of examples are absolutely amazing, because they did not find a village of Vikings who had a ship and went to America or something like that. This is 5,500 years before the anticipated event, I believe, so it's more than 10,000 years ago. And all they found is some residual that they couldn't even classify as human. And yet they can make a statement like that. That's amazing for me. Here's another story that is absolutely amazing. It goes back to Svante Paabo's work to sequence the Neanderthal, and here they found something in the cave in Siberia. In fact, he found that. Derevyanko, Anatoly Derevyanko, that allowed them by sequencing to state this is Homo. And not only is it Homo, it's a new species. It's not Neanderthal, it's not sapiens, it's something else, and they called it Denisovan. And it's the first time in the history of biology that a species has been named by genome sequencing. So all they had was a tip of a finger, and they completely ground up all the genetic material. And at the point that they published this, so this is from 2011, this was the highest resolved genome existing. So they had a much, much higher resolution here than for the human genome at that very point. But they had only one individual, a man. Anyway, another remarkable story. Let's get back to where can mutations happen. Non-coding, coding regions, so the variant can be in the non-coding region, this SNP can be in the coding region. In the coding region, you could sort of change the amino acid or could maintain the amino acid, right? You maintain the amino acid is called coding synonymous. Again, the other one is non-coding, and coding non-synonymous means change amino acid. At some point in history, that was referred to as SNP. Again, SNP strictly is only for a number in population. That had originally, that definition had to do with mistakes in the way we do the genome sequencing. So larger than some set was simply put in such that we are sure this is really a SNP, not a mistake. That's the only historical reason. With sequencing getting better, this became something nonsense, but is still a historically occupied word. So today, people begin to use SNF instead of SNP, the same thing. It's just the only difference is that they drop this constraint that you have to observe it in a certain percentage of the population, because we can now sequence individual cells. It's somehow the trick of biology to invent new words for old things to make it more interesting, or whatever. Non-synonymous then, historically were called NS-SNPs, or now NS-SNF, haven't seen that term yet. And now they're very recently, in fact, we have also begun to use this term here, SAV, as an acronym to single amino acid variant. So essentially this is an NS-SNF, so it's a single change of an amino acid, or a change of an amino acid that originates from a single nucleotide change. Complicated wording, whatever, it's a very simple story. There's one issue to remain here. With this, you could actually imagine that you change one native residue into 19 non-native. That's not what it is, because not every amino acid at every position can be reached. Okay, by a SNP or by a SNF. So by a single nucleotide change, you cannot always create all possible 19 substitutions or mutations. Anyway, that is a minor point. There's a classification of these things. Jana Bromberg, I think, for many slides, including this one, that classifies essentially the SNFs according to their risk, and the ones that change amino acid, the amino acid are very, very high up here. When we look at, this is a slide from Søren Brunak's group, OMIM disease and non-synonymous is green, synonymous is red. You see on different chromosomes here, you see that the green ones, the non-synonymous SNFs, are by far the most often observed related to disease, and they're in fact also the most severe ones. Clearly, these SAFs, as I'm going to from now on call them, so amino acid is changed by a single nucleotide change, or let's just more generally by a single amino acid change, can affect function. Here's an example from P53, you know, as a transcription factor that is involved in many problems related to cancer. Here are just five different diseases that come from five different SAFs, so point mutants. So five cases of one nucleotide change in P53 causing a disease. And very, very different ones here. And very different ones also in terms of metal. This is metal binding, this affects stability, this is acetylation, so signaling, this is DNA binding, and this is protein binding. So they are really completely different in terms of what you would call the functional impact. DNA binding, protein binding is something else. This is a signaling function, this is clearly something else, acetylation. Metal binding again is related to signaling. Stability is sort of more the overall thing of everything. If you want, first, the mother of all these SAFs or changes here is the one that happened in sickle cell, in the sickle cell disease. And this is a slide from Predro Karivoyat. So this is hemoglobin binding heme. In a particular tetrameric, as a tetramer, as you see here, if you change the position 6, the E at position 6 into a V, then instead of having a tetramer, you now get an aggregation, a stacking of these cells. And that stacking of these cells leads to the sickle cell disease that you can actually see directly under the microscope. And again, this was Pauling, Linus Pauling described this already in 49 as a single variant and with structural data. Interestingly enough, this is a gain of function if you want. So you gain a new binding partner. Something very destructive, and this does in fact happen. And again, as you know, Alzheimer, Parkinson are like that too. The fiber formation is, if you want, a gain of function. There are many methods, since there are diseases, you want to predict these effects of single amino acid changes, and there are many methods out there. In fact, there may be, so I recently saw somebody who counted over 150 distinct prediction methods. Now, let me detour before I go into that. I'm not going to present the 150. I'm going to have a quick run through 10, and then I'm going to give you more detail on one particular one. Let's get into something totally different. Single changes matter. How similar are we actually to mice? Does anybody know that? Can anybody throw a number at me? Or not on the level of the ear or the hair, I mean on the level of the genome?
Like gene-wise or protein-wise?
That's a good question. But if I ask you, how similar are the genomes from mice and men?
80%.
Anybody sort of questions that statement? Anybody wants to go this way or that way? I mean, not against or for him, but up more or less. So 80 is the first number. Anybody wants to up?
Reach a little bit more.
More?
5 to 90.
No, who goes with who? 85 to 90 or 80, the remainder of the group? They don't know.
More, yeah.
More. So you find a lot of numbers that, and again, this is complicated again how you do that, but letter by letter comparison, but it's very, very close to what you said, 85 to 93, when you do a letter by letter on the genome. However, and here's the other way of looking at it, from my, let's call it the group of our perspective, or the group of protein people, if you compare them protein by protein, and now you say, well, when I align two proteins, I want that at least 70% of all the residues of the two are overlapping. If not, I'm not going to compare these two, okay? So not to get into the domain problem. So I'm only going to look at the subset where at least 70% of the length overlaps. And then I say, I just look at the one, this, how many do I find for which sequence identity is higher than 70%? And then the answer is 70% of all the proteins are like that, 70, 70, 70. So for 70% of the proteins, the overlap is more than 70% of the length, and over that length, they have 70% sequence identity. So this may be, we may call that very high. But it's certainly a different number than 85, or even 90 for that matter, 80 for that matter, that you seem to have on the genome. So this clearly shows you that somehow just looking at the gene is not really telling the story. Looking at the protein level here clearly tells you a better story about this sort of perceived difference in the way a mouse and I look. Or you may not feel that way, but I at least feel very different. So the first generation methods are methods that you're well aware of. Again, just the background here is twofold. One type of this slide is it means that there is a lot of variation that can happen without changing structure or without affecting something. And it also tells you that the variation that happens being neutral is very specific. And that essentially gets you to the first method. Again, SIFT, you know. It comes from, well, one of the people behind it is Stephen Hanikoff, who has a lot of papers and a very high, already 7 years, 6 years ago, an H index of 83. This method is one, but the gene in the gene, the intron, also goes back to him. So now, histones do not only happen in octamers, comes from him. DNA methylation in histones also comes from him. So there's also the guy behind Blossom. It's just one of those people who change biology in many big, big steps. This is Pauline Nick, and Pauline was the one who really programmed the idea of using the, if you want, the Blossom matrix to predict the effect of a variant. Pauline now is in Singapore and does her work now focuses more on really combining information to understand diseases, including information on the level of text mining. And the idea essentially behind SIFT is if we had the variant E6 to V in this particular case, then compile a position-specific scoring matrix and ask, at that position 6, do I see the V? And do, if I do see the V, and if it is compatible with my matrix, essentially, so if it's likely, then I say, okay, that is neutral. If I don't see it, I call it not neutral. So in this particular situation, what happens is that the mother of all mutations of all disease-related single variants, single mutations, is in fact not recognized by this method and also not by others, including not ours. And the reason is because in rat, the same variant is perfectly healthy. Rats just carry that, so their rodents carry this variant and live with it. And that, of course, is difficult for these for many methods to see. Some methods can capture it, and I'll talk about that later. Polyphen essentially is a similar idea. The person behind it is Shamil Sunayev. who did it during his postdoc time at EMBL. This is a little bit outdated here, but polyphenol has an immense impact. You all know it is one way of showing this. And essentially, the idea behind polyphenol is similar to the one behind SIFT, except now the point is to really compute a probability. Rather than looking at the matrix, the logods of the matrix, compile a probability of what do I expect given all human sequences at that position. Okay? So that, yes, the alignment has an effect, but if I don't have enough sequences aligned, then I have another background model, the null model, which is all possible sequences. And this ultimately is done in a very clever way here. And that initially made polyphenol so successful. Here's the third initial method. And all of these essentially are methods that do not really optimize parameters. One or two parameters more or less than something, and then that's it. And they look at conservation. This one here looks at structure. It says if, so that's the method going back to John Moult. And so the argument here is if I had the three-dimensional structure, and if I knew that my blue residues are on the surface, my red ones are on the, in the inside, and now I have the E6-2V, it depends on whether it's on the outside or the inside, whether I call that effect. So I just have a differential behavior. That is ultimately the idea behind this one here. And it does clearly work. Now let's talk about the collection of data if we wanted to test methods or if we wanted to do more than that, like machine learning. So data will be available on the level of really entire animals. So one looks different from another. So I have a sequence variant and that affects a big change this on this level, right? Then the sequence variant could affect something like a change in the culture. It's almost like this, but a little bit more subtle. It could affect something on the cellular level. And it could affect something on the biochemical binding level. So you could have a change in binding energy. When a protein binds a substrate, you test the mutant and it changes binding. So all of these kind of ideas are collected, were collected in a database that is no longer maintained, PMD. And this is the typical record from that database. It was done from Japan, and there was another database that was essentially done by reading many, many papers. When you collected all the ones somehow that were of this type that I show here, and that was done by Jana Bromberg, then what she found is about 40,000 had an effect. About 14,000 were neutral. Why do you believe that the imbalance is that high?
I think it proves something to be neutral.
That's a very important issue. So it's much more difficult to prove that a variant is neutral because it's neutral under some conditions only. But the effect that you see, no matter, as long as the conditions that you have somehow sampled in vivo conditions, any way you show effect is effect. While neutral could be because there are some effects that are possible that you didn't see, because maybe another protein has to bind, or maybe it has to be in a different compartment. Maybe it needed some other ingredient. It needed DNA to be next to it, or whatever, right? So that is why neutral is more complicated. There's another reason for the imbalance. And the other reason for the imbalance essentially is that experiments typically start when something goes wrong. So you typically investigate things that in fact are changes. It is because it's easier, so somehow this is a circular argument, but it's also because research is driven. I mean, we are trying to understand diseases. We are, a lot of research is going on by, is sort of driven by observing some variant that causes some disease. And it's always something that goes wrong, right? There's always something that is in effect. So it's also the focus of studies. Now, one problem in this may be machine learning. Is it true? So we are trying to create a data set that machine learns to predict the effect of a variant. Is such an imbalance a problem for machine learning? Well, you somehow have all seen it in the DNA prediction, or the RNA prediction, right? That's a major problem. So sometimes you sort of try to get out of it by just oversampling that class, and sometimes that sort of works. Could you imagine a way in which you sort of could in silico create a few neutrals? Recording mode. No, so the idea, one idea is you take two proteins for which you experimentally have determined the enzymatic activity. Here, sequence one, sequence two, protein one and protein two. This is the particular EC number. So they're both hydrolases. They both exactly have this EC number here. And they differ. Now you argue that since they both exactly do the same thing, they're not too different. We're not talking about two proteins that are 30% sequence identical. We're talking about two proteins that are 80% sequence identical. So they're largely similar. They do the same thing. Wherever they differ, it should be neutral. So, of course, what is wrong in this argument is they may have another function there. There they may differ. But a lot of the neutral ones I capture by that. And we do know now that we need these data sets. And we do also know that there's a mistake in this. So we make many mistakes in here, but we cannot live without this data set. So refining that is one of the issues that remains to be done somehow. Maybe it's not the most urgent issue, but that's also why we haven't addressed it so far. Maybe it turns out to be more urgent than I believe it is. Anyway, with this in silico set so far, so to speak, the EC, this data set got balanced. So roughly 40,000 effect, 40,000 neutral from about 6,800 proteins. When you look at buried versus exposed, you see that in fact they differ between buried neutral and effect. So here the buried is 75% has an effect, while exposed is it is not the ratio. So the ratio neutral to non-neutral for exposed is 1.6. Most of them are neutral. Buried, most of them are not neutral. And that again is somehow expected, you may argue, because inside of the protein, a lot of the changes, so the density inside is higher. Just imagine you have a position where two relatively small amino acids are crammed together, and you changed both of them into a large residue, or at least one, you would push out something. You would just add volume, and this volume simply will make the protein bigger. And that may turn into a problem. While on the surface, if you're not in the binding site, such a change shouldn't matter that much. Yes, the matter of charge on the surface would change. But again, a matter of charge could also change inside. And this is the intuitive explanation for that. The second generation method, and the way I classify them here, is the first generation really used very simple ideas, small data sets, essentially a few parameters. So completely done by SIFT, PolyFence, Snap S3D, while the second generation really uses data sets and machine learning and begins to optimize larger sets of parameters. And the third generation in this uses even larger data set that also are mixed data sets, for instance, bringing in the disease concerns. So Jana developed SNAP, and I'm going to talk most of the time on SNAP. Some other method in parsing, let's begin right there. So the first one here is SDM. It's an old method too, and it's a method that, again, you could also argue is the first generation method. So there's a thermodynamical cycle. So you have a wild type folded, wild type unfolded, change of the wild type, so the mutant version here unfolded, and the mutant version folded. And you can, for all these transitions here, for all these four transitions, you can experimentally measure the delta G of change. It's on again. So since you can easily measure not easily, but you can measure all of these points. You can create large data sets. And this comes from the group of Tom Blundell. So experimental changes, calculated changes, since you have large data sets, you can essentially fit simple linear regression models without a lot of machine learning, loads of data that allow you to predict the impact on the delta G of binding. Here is a similar idea from Marianne Ruhmann called Pop Music, that essentially does the same, uses the same data, but it trains it in machine learning devices. Where again, we don't, mind you, compared to what I talked about before, we really have a variant effect on generic idea of function. Here we have very specific delta G of binding in a particular context, right? This is a slightly different way of looking at it, if you want. Here is the same thing on the level of binding energy, delta G for a larger data set. Again, is done, this particular one is also done by neural networks, this time by Emilio Capriotti and Rita Casadio and Piero Foriselli. Here is a piece of, here's an approach, Automute, from Josef Weizmann. Josef Weizmann is one of those people who works on docking methods. So essentially trying, once you have a three-dimensional structure of a protein, of two proteins, can you find exactly the way they bind? That's typically what we refer to as docking. And that is typically what you always, what any pharmaceutical company uses, because they always have a 3D structure and they want to change the way proteins bind. Now, in order to do this docking, you essentially create potentials that tell you what is the preference for binding like this versus binding like that. And these he can use to, in fact, also predict, again, in a similar fashion of fitting parameters to in a linear regression model. It's not even linear regression, it's a simple parameter fit, and can predict the effect upon binding for variants. Here is Provian. You may have come across it last semester, some of you have come across it clearly. So the Provian idea is, as opposed to SIFT, they create subfamilies and subtrees, and we will see that concept in a minute again. So when you, so far SIFT looks at it, we is essentially that is protein 1, 2, 3, 4 in a family, and you ask, what is it that I observe in a particular position, in the position where I have the variant? Now, Provian, if anybody needs help with her, tell me. So Provian comes more from this idea, when you think about proteins related through a tree, then the moment you split a tree, you have particular residues that are relevant for that split. It's that residue, right? And so Provian essentially asks, not do we have a residue that changes in this overall probability, but do we is the change one of these sort of tree-changing residues, one of these central residues that define species? And they don't do it directly through a tree, but through a method that allows them to do it tree-free, so to speak. Here we have mutation taster. A mutation taster is simply a machine learning device, Bayesian network, using OMIM disease variants. You all know OMIM disease variants. I don't have to explain that. So simply a simple data set of things that have a known disease impact. Here is Acton, or Action, sorry, from the group of Oliver Lickcharge. And the idea essentially goes back, so Oliver was one of the people who sort of worked out this idea of residues that are relevant for tree changing behavior. And essentially he sort of optimized now gradient potential that he puts into an equation, a physical equation, that essentially is an equation that measures the fitness of a variant, or the fitness for change, if you want. Ultimately, it's a fit in a clever fit in this landscape of changes. Here is a method that from the group of Chris Sander and Boris Reva, and it goes back to an older idea where you simply look at particular positions. In this particular position, SIFT would essentially say here there's a 3 in 7 probability of an E and a 3 in 7 probability of an N. Okay, so the E to N would be mostly neutral because you observe the N. Now, what that ignores is if you were to be part of the subfamilies that sit here, that sit up here, then the observation of the N is very unlikely. So whether you can accept the N to E depends on which subfamily you are. Okay, and that is not at all captured in the PSSM. Right? The idea is clear to everybody. Yeah? And essentially, it's not that simple to really put this into an equation and compile a score, but what they show that this score, and as Boris has worked on that for many years, and has come up with a solution for which he can show that it is relevant for modeling cancer and very, very important to distinguish between disease and not disease. Here, an idea again is related but slightly different, evolutionary couplings. I talked about it on Tuesday. Ultimately, going back to Thomas Hopf, or Chris Sander and Deborah Marx, where we look at correlated positions and essentially try to see when you have correlated positions, then you also see correlated changes, and you can see how correlated positions, in fact, will react to a single variant. And that's the idea here. A lot of information packed upon a slide. Ultimately, what this is, and I'll go back to this, this is a large-scale study where there is a correlation between experimentally measuring a lot of changes, so for many variants in one protein, a substrate complex, and here the predicted one, and there's a clear correlation. So this method is extremely involved, extremely complex, is in fact Thomas' PhD thesis, highly non-trivial, and it works amazingly well, but unfortunately it's now accepted. It will be published in 17, still not out, but it's only applicable in cases where you have very, very large alignments. How to compare methods? Traditionally, you would do it in a way in which David Baker did it in this slide. So you line up a bunch of methods, you compile a set of scores, accuracy here in the last one, most likely slightly overquoted the number of digits that are supported by the data. The problem with that is there is an immense amount of information and the answer doesn't really get back into your head. And the question is whether the data that we originally start this with is good enough to sort of make the comparison on this level of detail. And I'll get back into that. So the answer ultimately is no. The data that we have is not good enough to really support analysis like this. I want to begin with a method that goes back to Jana Bromberg, who is now professor at Rutgers University. Effect prediction through machine learning. In fact, that's what she did first. And it's the same thing that you have seen before. You have 13 consecutive residues in a protein and put them into, in this particular case, a neural network, and you have some two output units, effect and neutral. And now the story gets slightly different, so each blurb here is 20 input units for the 20 amino acids plus a spacer. Now you need another one, of course, that is what is the native and what is the change. And that immediately tells you that the story gets more complicated. So now maybe what you want to put in here, so this is like 13 ellipsoids here. Instead of 13, you would have 14, because you also want to say what the center one is mutated to. But now you could also, instead of doing that, you could, at every single position, look at differential features. So maybe not for the 13 to 14, but one input set of features may be secondary structure. Okay, now you could put in the secondary structure that you predict for the P, and if the P changed to a K, what would the secondary structure be for the K? So then you have three input units. Instead, you could sort of merge them into one by looking at a differential unit. So instead of saying one is a helix and one is strand, you would put in one changes from helix to strand. Okay, and it turns out that when we look at the input features that help us, that sometimes we need these differential features are advantages, and sometimes it is better to take the original features. And again, this animation, I'm sorry for that. Ultimately, the features that were most useful are biophysical features, alignment profiles, the probability of residue triplets, solvent accessibility, secondary structure, and residue flexibility. Then we also use annotated features, whether we are in a PFAM domain and whether we have search plot annotations. Overall, we get a network that has two output units, one for effect, one for neutral. This typically scales from 0 to 1 after the hyperbolic detangents applied. This from 0 to 1. But we scale this onto a score of minus 100 to plus 100 by simply integer 100, so times 100 and take an integer of the value. And then we subtract one unit from the other. So this one here is neutral, and this is effect. Okay? So in terms of units here, it is 100 if this unit is 1 and this 0, and it's minus 100 if this unit is 1 and this is 0. Okay? Those are the two extremes of the story. The overall performance, again, the Baker's kind of way for four different proteins for which we had relatively large sets at the time. It's a Q2, meaning I ask how many of the SAFs are predicted correctly in a two-state model, right? And there are different methods here, PolyFence, SIFT, SNAP at the time, and SNPs 3D at the time. We did this, those were the only methods that were available. Now, overall, there are some differences and some similarities. I'll get back to that later. When we look at more detail, accuracy versus coverage, by, in fact, looking into the entire rock life curves, you see that for effect and neutral, we have buried versus buried red versus exposed blue, and we see that for the ones that have effect, we're doing much better for buried residues. So we're predicting better the effect of buried residues, and we are predicting better the neutrality of exposed residues. So it's inverted. Now, the curve here was created by going through, essentially zooming through the strengths, the prediction strength or the reliability. Essentially, if this unit were 0.8 and this point 0.2, then this is predicted to be effect. If it would be like this, it's also effect. This one is stronger. So on the scale of these numbers here, essentially the default is 0. Oh, that's a bug. Oh, green. So the default is 0, and essentially increasing reliability is a curve like this, right? The higher the positive value, the stronger the prediction, the more I assume this is reliable. And this is something that as a developer I have to...
So anyway,
what I'm going to do now is I'm going to show you what happens if I looked only at the very strong predictions? Or how does it look if I look at all of them? So on the x-axis, you see the percentage of residues that are predicted. 100%, so you predict all residues if you use the score 0. So if you say any difference, so higher than 0 is effect, lower than 0 is not effect, it's neutral, then for every single residue I get a prediction. Okay? Now, if I used the 50% strongest, so that's the line somehow here. Okay? The 50% strongest here, and unfortunately I don't have a, I don't want to move. So the 50% strongest here and the 50% strongest here, the effect is in red, the neutral is in green, so 50% strongest in green is a slightly different point here than red. But what you see is at the 50% point here marked by the number 4, you roughly see that the prediction accuracy for effect prediction rises from 78% to roughly 88%. So without knowing anything, you can give the user an idea for that particular variant they are interested in, what the expected accuracy of that is, whether that is a stronger one or not. Now, the next question would be, okay, this is my probability of getting a right prediction. Is that related to the experiment? Is that related to the effect of the experiment, right? So I could simply ask, again, here's 100, here's minus 100, and I have three different data sets here. Neutral in green, severe effect in red, and somewhere in between effect in blue. And you see that the red set is moved much more to the right than the blue. By binary classification, red and blue would both be called effect, but more effect is enriched in red, and you see more effect is moved to the right. So stronger prediction means more likely correct, but it also means stronger effect. Okay? And stronger effect, by the way, we found examples where this can be gain of function and loss of function in both directions. Here are some examples for that. When we ask, so initially, in fact, we trained SNAP independently differently for buried, intermediate, and exposed residues. So it essentially three SNAP versions. But now that is no longer the case. And for these different models, we did that because what if I gave you enough time, which because of a variety of reasons I don't, you would see that the relevance of particular features here can jump that high, right? Which feature is important where, or which feature is important as input, differs between these three different models, or these three different versions. That means that we could have a machine learning device zoomed into what is important for buried and what is important for exposed residues. Here's a different example. So when we use annotation, so we get a higher accuracy than when we don't use annotations, but these annotations are hardly ever found. So for the vast majority, the type of annotations that really helped us, there were not many of those available. And this is actually tricky to have, you cannot put that into one machine learning device. You cannot put that into a typical machine learning device. Because the machine learning device, if it,
sorry.
Thank you. Oh, they're still running. The machine learning device in most cases will simply not see this annotation feature and will not use it. That's why, in fact, in this particular case, we have two different machine learning devices. One for when annotations are available and one for when they are not. In this particular case here, what you show is the server that is online available. So where in this particular case, when you have a structure, you see the structure, and on that structure, you see what variants affect what. Now, you can do that here. That jumps a little bit ahead. in my slides, but what I show here is red means that, so I'm now going to change position in look at many variants of the position, and red means essentially all the variants, all the mutations, the SAFs, are predicted to have an effect. Blue means essentially all of them are predicted not to have an effect. And you somehow, maybe if the quality would be better and if this thing still would turn, no, I don't know why. Somehow I lost the movie. The rotation. You would see that in fact the binding site is red. So essentially, looking at whatever is in the structure, a local area with a lot of sensitivity to change, gets you to a binding site visually. To actually put that into a method is more challenging and so far not really successful. Let me now give you one way in which we can compare, in the simplest way, three different methods. And this is the Q2, for in this particular case here, for a larger data set. So Jana worked on this about 5 years. And after 5 years, she got SNAP. And then she saw this, right? She saw SIFT, Polyfen, good, that she improved. 5 years of work, right? You want to jump. This is random. So now I would ask you, if you had worked on this for 5 years, and this is as much as your method jumped. So that's how they did without doing much from random, and that's how much you improved. How happy would you be with that, right? And then typically what people do at that moment is they blow up tables and they put up more numbers and they argue there are some ways to measure accuracy in which my method actually does work better. And that is certainly true. But here's a completely different way of doing that. And that way simply asks, okay, let's just say that there are some variants where every method somehow gets the prediction right. So ideally we find them by, let's take all the ones where SIFT and Polyfen agree, or where all three methods agree. And then say these are trivial. Let's take all the others where any two disagree and say those are more complicated variants, all right? And when we do that, then that's the performance. So again, this is a subset. This is a subset of variants with experimental characterization where at least two of these three methods disagree. And for that subset, you see now, in fact, that you sort of have a strong argument for what you developed. So SNAP, and for that subset, the overall number before here was at almost 80, 78 or something like that. So it drops significantly. So for tougher cases, SNAP does much worse. But the others do so much more worse, in fact they do worse than random at this point, that you can really be proud. And that is one way of looking at that. There are many other ways, and in fact what we began to appreciate by looking at this is that when we compile performance for the sets of scores for which experimental variants are known, then we bias our system to variants where everybody has used and for which everybody somehow has optimized their model. And we overlook how much they actually differ. So we could argue that essentially they do the same thing. And when we sort of predicted for all possible mutants in human, we saw that they do very, very different things. Okay, and our group, all other groups had completely overlooked that. And ultimately, we started to sort of realize that when we looked at this aspect here. So a differential. So comparing method in this way, this is sort of new. The table way in which we have a table with all the methods is the traditional way. And this is very important because ultimately it addresses the question, what is it that you and your publication bring to the table that is new? that was not there before. And it's not only pushing the number from 72 to 73 or 4 or 5. It is also doing something for some other situations, maybe. And that's one example of that. There was a new generation of method done by Max Hecht, but I will get back to that one on Tuesday. And I will close it here for today. Thank you for your attention.